Well, good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. I have apologies from committee members Gordon MacDonald and Andy Whiteman. Now, I would ask everyone present to turn electrical devices to silent or turn any off that might interfere with the sound system. The first item on the agenda is item one, which is a decision by the committee to take item four in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, today we have with us for our first panel of witnesses three witnesses whom I would like to welcome at this stage in our gender pay gap inquiry. And the first of all, we have Emma Gibbs, going from left, my left to right, who is a partner in McKinsey & Company. Welcome to you. Second, we have Dr. Tanya Wilson, who is an early career fellow at the University of Stirling. Again, welcome. And last but not least, Professor David Bell, who is Professor of Economics at the University of Stirling. And again, welcome to you. So we'll start this morning with a question from committee member Julian Martin. And just to indicate, you don't need to press any buttons. The sound desk will look after that. I'd remind members to keep their questions succinct and to the point, and also ask the witnesses if they try to do likewise. And at this point, I'll pass over to Julian Martin.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. My question is specifically for Emma Gibbs, McKinsey. It's about your report last year, where you had a best in UK scenario that was modelled. And I'd like to ask, you had the three different scenarios that came out that were modelled in that. If you take us through how they were modelled, and as a sort of supplementary question off the back of that, how have you arrived at any assumptions that would relate to Scotland specifically?
So the model looks at the contribution that women make to the economy in three dimensions. First of all, their participation rate in the labour market. Second of all, the number of hours that they work. And third of all, the sectors that they work in. We largely took ONS data in order to be able to, Office of National Statistics data, in order to be able to populate the model. And we used projections from Oxford Economics for our forward GDP projections. We looked at the regions using the NUTS classification, which are the 12 regions, Scotland being one of the regions. And we looked at the sectors of the economy based on the 19 subsectors that ONS reports against. So the three scenarios that we modelled, the first was the business as usual case. So that was simply taking the Oxford Economics projections, looking at historical labour participation rates for women and hours worked and their sector contributions, and saying if the pace of change continued the same as what it's done for the last decade, what would women's contribution to the economy be? We then looked at a full parity scenario where we effectively said, let's assume in 2025 that women are equal to men insofar as they are participating in the economy at the same rate, they're working the same number of hours, and they're represented in the 19 subsectors equally. We didn't take into account any differences in the sort of work that women might do in those sectors. We simply looked at individuals in those sectors as having an equal contribution to productivity and therefore to the economy. The best in UK scenario was somewhere in between the two, where we said, we're not sure it's realistic to assume that in 10 years we're going to reach full parity. So therefore, let's look at what the best rate of improvement has been in the UK at a regional level. So we said for labour participation, what has been the fastest improvement over the course of the last 10 years? Let's assume that every region now can improve at that same rate. We didn't try and say, let's assume everybody can, all regions can get to the same level. We thought that was unrealistic given the low base for some regions. But we said, let's assume that the pace can be equal. We then did the same for hours, and then we did the same for movements in women's contribution to different subsectors. So that's how we arrived at the best in UK scenario. And that's the 150 billion GDP in 2025 figure that we've come up with. So some of the assumptions that we've made in that, we have assumed that every region in the UK can improve at the fastest rate that somebody has over the course of the last 10 years. we have assumed that men and women's contribution to individual sectors is economically the same. We have not assumed that men's participation in the economy or contribution to GDP will reduce as women come in. Largely, we've done that because as we looked at over the last 10 years, as we looked at how women's participation has changed, men's participation has not changed as women's participation has grown. And therefore, because we were predicting or we were projecting a similar level of increase for women's participation, we thought it was a safe assumption that men's participation would not be affected by women moving into the economy. What we also haven't looked at is the demand side. We have simply looked at the supply side of the economy. We've looked at what would happen if you could put more workers into the economy, assuming that the economy could absorb those workers and grew as a result of them. Again, the reason we think that's a reasonably good assumption is because the UK has a number of skills shortages and many in the sectors that women are underrepresented. So therefore, we thought that was a relatively safe assumption. We didn't take into account the economic contribution that women make in unpaid work. Again, we think that would be an interesting study for somebody else to do, but we looked at GDP, which doesn't include unpaid work. So there are a number of assumptions, but nevertheless, we think it was a sound approach to be able to come up with what we think is a reasonably realistic figure of 150 billion if we were able to make similar pace as the best regions have managed over the course of the last 10 years.
And effectively making an economic case that is realistic based on what's happening in one particular scenario that is realistic, which doesn't really, and I'm just jumping across to the other study briefly, because I know that a lot of my colleagues are going to come in. You didn't have that same result, really. I mean, I noticed you said that there wasn't really a very clear economic case for...
We weren't saying that, you know, that things couldn't change. What we were focusing on was what had changed and why we thought it had changed in relation to pay in particular, in relation to men and women. We didn't say all that much about participation. instead, our focus has principally been on pay and what's happened in relation to pay.
Okay. Just one other thing that I wanted to ask before I hand over to my colleagues. The best in UK model, you said it didn't account for any kind of the types of work. So there wasn't any analysis of the impacts of automation or any technological innovations in the future as we go forward. That wasn't looked at all.
To the extent that Oxford Economics have included those kinds of things in their underlying projections, they would be included. Right. What we haven't done is assumed any additional change in sector productivity. We haven't assumed any change we also haven't assumed any change in the nature of the work that men and women do. We've simply said if you're in, for example, the agricultural sector typically has this level of productivity. Therefore, if you put another person into the agricultural sector, then you'll have X percent more. So we haven't done any additional thinking about what the impact of technology would be beyond what Oxford Economics might have done in their base projections. What we would note, though, is that there are a number of sectors where women are already quite prevalent, which are some of the sectors which are least susceptible to technological replacement and automation and whatnot, which, you know, is perhaps an interesting area as well to think about.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And now John Mason.
Thanks so much. And kind of following on some of the points that Gillian Martin was raising, but I think you said, if I understood you correctly, that you'd kind of assumed that women moving into other sectors which are male-dominated at the moment would give addition. But I mean, from a kind of, you know, my thinking is, would it not be more obvious that if 10 women move out of childcare to run a big engineering company, 10 men are going to move out of the engineering company into childcare? And therefore, there would be no effect on the economy. Is that not a kind of logical assumption?
Well,
I think the reason that we believe that there's room for more people to go into productive sectors is because there's such a skill shortage in productive sectors. So I think engineering, some of the engineering institutions are projecting a million engineering shortages over the course of the next 10 years, and women are particularly underrepresented in engineering, for example. So in that case, you could see that you could add many more women to a sector like engineering, a highly productive sector, and that wouldn't displace men necessarily.
Okay, but it would leave a shortage in childcare.
Unless you also include women participating more in the economy, which was part of what we assumed. So more women joining the economy, working more hours, and also moving into more productive sectors.
Yes. So I'm wondering then, would there be a knock-on effect? Because you said, yes, there wouldn't be a difference in productivity maybe, but would that maybe have a positive impact on low pay in some of the care sectors? Because if there was a shortage of staff in that area, they're going to be forced to increase their pay?
Well, we haven't. We don't believe that there is We believe you can add 840,000 jobs for women under our best in UK scenario. So we're talking about adding jobs rather than just shifting people around. So we're not talking about shifting people out of one sector to the detriment of that sector. We're talking about adding women and putting those women to the extent that you can into more productive sectors as well. It's worth saying that two-thirds of the 150 million benefit can be achieved simply by increasing women's participation in the workforce and increasing the number of hours they do to the tune of an additional 30 minutes per day without doing anything to do with sectors. So we're not suggesting that we're just moving the deck chairs, if you like. We're also talking about putting more women into the economy, which is why we believe that there's an opportunity to increase the size of the economy with more women participating, particularly in some of these more productive sectors where there are skill shortages, and women moving into more managerial positions, which are also an area where there are skill shortages. What we didn't look at in any fashion was the impact on pay. We simply looked at GDP. We did not look at what would be the impact on pay.
Okay, so maybe I can switch that question over to Dr. Wilson and Professor Bell, that, you know, if that argument is correct, that we've got all these kind of spare hours we can put into engineering, then the care sector would just be left the same and would still stay at low pay and still be perhaps dominated by women. Is there some answer to that?
Well, I'll start and maybe Tanya can follow. I mean, we do tell our students in labour economics about the lump of labour fallacy, which is the idea that there are a set number of jobs in the economy. It just doesn't work like that. So, you know, if you take a group of people from one sector, move them to another, then it isn't necessarily the case that that the result of that will be that the whole level of demand for jobs in the economy will stay the same. There will be multiplier effects. So because the additional workers have come in at higher levels of productivity, they will spend more, which will create more opportunities for jobs in the future. So I don't think it's right to think of it as just swapping different parts of the economy.
But in terms of childcare itself, we can see that during the prime childbearing ages, this is when we really see participation by women falling. And they're, as part of the survey, individuals are asked why that they're not working or why they're not working full-time, and child caring duty seems to be a very, very important part of that. So insofar as to encourage women to participate more in the labour market sector, then that would push up demand for childcare, and with higher demand, that should command a premium in prices for childcare, i.e. the wages that those workers in the childcare sector would receive.
Okay, no, that's helpful. Thanks for just now. Yep.
Thank you. And I'll move on to Gil Patterson.
Well, my question maybe is related to that, and we look at your submission on page 26, and you're talking about labour market entry, and at that particular time, wages and salaries seem to be fairly similar, but in a 10-year period, then there's a gap occurs, and I wondered, in your 6.2, you say that it's caused by age, and I'm wondering if that is actually the real case. And I wonder if it's interruptions that cause this gap to appear, where in some businesses that if you're time served, then there's a, you know, you're commanding, no matter what your gender is, because you're time served, then you enjoy a better salary. Whereas if you're interrupting through, pregnancy or other elements, taking care of the family or schooling, etc., then there's a kind of gap occurs there, and I wonder if you have any evidence on that.
So there are two aspects to labour market experience. So there is experience within the labour market, regardless of which job that you're doing, which commands, like, you know, you would think, the longer that you're working, the more productive, the better that you go and get at working, and that that commands a wage premium. But as you quite rightly say, the longer that you're within a specific firm as well, the more valuable you become to that firm, and therefore your wages go increase accordingly. So what we find in the data is at labour market entry that the wages between men and women are equal, pretty much. Like, the gender gap is negligible. And we first see this gender gap, this pay gap emerging within the first 10 years of labour market experience. However, this big widening occurs during what we would call the childbearing ages, potentially because, as you're saying, if you're taking a career interruption in order to go and look after children, it's not possible to go, and you're missing out on those extra years of labour market experience. So when you return, there's some period that you've missed out on.
Yeah. So, I mean, a very typical pattern is absence from the labour market for a couple of years and then return to work part-time rather than full-time. And, the evidence for that... Well, one of the bits of evidence, interestingly, is around the fact that part-time females get paid more than part-time males, and that's partly because they're better qualified. So they haven't gone back into the full-time route through their career. Instead, they're staying part-time, but many of them very well qualified are... better qualified than the average male part-timer, therefore get paid more. And then the question is really, well, is this decision a voluntary decision, or is it a decision that's forced on them by circumstances like the absence of affordable childcare and so on? That seems to us to be a critical nexus about why that decision is made.
We would agree. When we looked at both gender equality indicators in the workforce, and we also looked at gender equality indicators in society. And what we would note is that as a woman moves through her life, the indicators get worse in the UK. That women start off relatively equal, and then as they move through to their careers, it gets a bit harder. And then by the time they become mothers, if they choose to become mothers, then many indicators get much tougher, including, for example, the how many more hours on unpaid care they spend than their male counterparts. There's also a piece of research that has been done that shows for skilled mothers, for every year they take out of the paid workforce doing unpaid childcare, they have a lasting reduction in their pay of 4%, which does suggest there's a real penalty with taking time out. And therefore, one of the big recommendations that we make to business, and certainly that we talk about in our report, or indeed to all employers, is helping women and men share childcare responsibilities, share leave periods, and then when they return to work, come back into their career tracks, so that they don't suffer this penalty.
Is that reduction, though, based on the gap that's created in training, or keeping up with the changes that take place within a workplace, or is it this time served component where you have missed pay rises for a given number of years? Is there any evidence on that?
I would need to come back to you on that. I don't know if you guys have looked at that. Okay.
And there's a certain argument that with a career break, your skills, shall we say, depreciate, i.e., because you're taking an interruption, you're not, it's possible that you're not keeping up to date with the newest technology. What doesn't seem to go and be recognised is that you may be taking an individual may be taking time out of the workplace, but it's not. They're doing other skills that could be enhanced. There doesn't seem to go and be a premium for other skills that are potentially developed during this period. So insofar as may not be keeping up to date with current skills that are required in the workplace, this would feed into your argument that the time that reduction in time served within the firm would be important, and would suggest that potential programs to encourage training as an individual comes back to work after a career interruption, so that they, in essence, come back with that level of missed skills, or, you know, so return to work programs there could be quite helpful in addressing that skill deficit.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for that.
I think Gillian Martin wanted to come in with a supplementary.
Supplementary. It's not just at around about 30s, though, when women take career breaks for having children, that the gap widens. Women over 50 have got quite a large... So it's not just about taking time out to have children. Have you done any analysis on why that's happening for women over 50 as well, that the gap's widening even further at that point?
So, certainly the gap opens and doesn't close. It may widen further. It is important to, it's quite a subtle point, but there's a distinction between age and cohort effects. So although we've kind of said that the gap may be wider for those aged 50 currently, what we're seeing at the beginning of the labour market now is much smaller levels of size of the pay gap, and our analysis shows that for those aged, what was it, 35 to 55, it's much larger. Now, we have a difficulty in trying to figure out whether that gap will be there in 20 years' time, or whether the gap that is relatively small now will move along with the people who are currently aged 30, say, as they become more mature in the labour market, the effect of the general pressure to reduce the gender pay gap will actually mean that in 20 years' time, that 50, age 50 pay gap won't be as big as it currently is. It's almost impossible from the data to figure out whether that's going to be the case or not.
One thing to go and follow on from there is approximately 30 years ago, the education attainment gap reversed. So following on what David was saying, for cohorts aged approximately 50 and above, it's the case that men's educational attainment on average is higher than women's, whereas for those cohorts currently aged 50 and below, the reverse is the case. And this complicates the matter even further, because that, as you say, that widening gap age 15 and above, that may also be due to differences in education, which is, as cohorts age through the system, that differences will no longer exist. So it's very difficult to disentangle those two effects.
Yeah. The gender pay gap doesn't exist because women haven't got the education. It exists because of other factors that happens to them when they're in the workplace. You know, you'll have female graduates dropping off, at points when they're in their career.
So
So our analysis it specifically tries to get at that issue. So we take into account differences in education and differences in experience and see what is left that is unexplained. And that bit that is left that is unexplained is the bit that we would say, well, that must be due to some form of discrimination or, you know, some unexplained component in the difference between men's and women's pay. Now, you're absolutely right that the educational gap has gone in favour of women. Women are, on average, better qualified. One qualification to that, which we mentioned in the paper, is there is an issue around subject. But our evidence also shows that in terms of experience, which is something Tanya was talking about as well, typically men used to have more experience with the company that they were in. That doesn't seem to be the case so much in Scotland. So pretty much all of the stuff we can explain about wage differences now is either in favour of women or neutral, with this big exception around subjects and occupational choice, which is another issue that probably we should come back to. But what's left is that component of the difference in pay that is difficult to explain, and one might say, well, this is the the part that could be explained by discrimination.
Move on to a question from Bill Bowman.
Thank you, convener. Ask a couple of questions. The first one is a standard one we ask all of our panels. I'll just read it so that I don't get it wrong, although I've asked it often enough. Does the panel believe we have a defined set of agreed statistics on female economic activity in Scotland and on the pay gap? I don't know if you're putting your head in your hands is a And the second question is, what correlation, if any, has there been between the narrowing of the gender pay gap in Scotland and economic growth over the past decade? So statistics first.
Statistics first. We've many ways to calibrate men's and women's pay. There are two main sources for that. We use one for our the analysis we have in our paper. There's another called ASH, which is an employer's side view of how much people are paid. There are, you know, arguments around which of the particular sets of statistics you should use: the hourly pay gap, the weekly pay gap, the annual pay gap, or the lifetime difference in earnings. And all of these give slightly, or well, not slightly, in some cases very significantly different answers, partly because, say, if you take the lifetime, then the career gap that may have occurred will increase the overall difference between men's and women's pay. And then things like pension contributions should be added in, you know, to get an idea of the overall difference. If you take that lifetime perspective, we are not coming down on any particular one of these because I think they suit different purposes. But it is interesting that the OECD uses the full-time weekly pay, and that's the one that you can use if you want to compare Scotland with other countries. That's the one where the OECD have done the work in terms of doing the calculation. The other thing about the statistics on this, and we make the point in the paper, is that, you know, it's Kuznets who said, you know, what we should be trying to measure with a measure of the overall activity in the economy is the activity of businesses, of government, and of households. And we can make a reasonably good go at businesses. We can make a bit of a go at the public sector government. And we add those two together and call them GDP. we don't make any effort really to value the contribution of towards overall economic well-being, which is made by activity within the household. It's inherently a difficult thing to do, but obviously, you know, if you do the meal in the house and the meal in the restaurant, there's a very pretty stark contrast in that the latter contributes to GDP and the former does not. You know, depends on the well, that's just the way that national income accounting works.
So going into the technicalities of how to compare the statistics used to compare pay between men and women, I mean, ideally what we would like to do is we would like to go and compare equal amounts of work done and the remuneration between the two, and whether that should, you know, some may think that should be best be captured by, for instance, hourly pay. But given that many people are not paid by the hour, they don't actually report their hourly pay. They give perhaps their weekly pay or their monthly pay or their annual pay, which may be an accurate figure or may be an estimate. And then they go and give an estimate of the number of hours that they work within a given week. And it's a statistical construct that you divide an estimate by an estimate, and you go and get something that's incredibly imprecise. What I'm saying from that is this measure that we can go and get, for instance, from the Office of National Statistics, the Labour Force survey on hourly pay can be shown to go and be very imprecise compared to, for instance, the ASH data, which uses administrative data. However, the hours that someone reports working in a given week is an estimate of their... For most people, it's an estimate of their hours. So I would say that I work 40 hours a week, but that fluctuates between 38 and probably 43 in any given week.
I don't have anything to add to what the other two have said.
So just to return to that. So there is a debate over which of the measures is the most appropriate to use. So we in our analysis, we use the weekly wages, given that people are more likely to be able to accurately report how many weeks that they worked, or alternatively, did you work all year? That means that they worked a full 52 weeks. And it reduces the bias somewhat in the statistics that are reported.
Yeah, I think also, I mean, it has been argued that the distinction between part-time and full-time is also a fairly arbitrary distinction. That's probably true. You know, and also we don't say anything about the nature of pay differences dependent on the kind of contract that people have. So, you know, 0 hours contracts, other contracts, temporary contracts, and then full-time contracts differences in the gender pay gap according to the type of contract that's on offer. And of course, decisions that people make about whether to apply for jobs that, you know, these kinds of contracts are on offer for, you know, will influence whether employers pay well or pay badly. If 0 hours contracts aren't very popular, then employers will find they'll have to pay more per hour to attract people to that kind of job.
Okay, thank you for those comments. Then moving on to the question of the narrowing of the gender pay gap in Scotland and the growth in GDP.
I think the dominant thing in the last 10 years has been the Great Recession, as it's called. And there has been a marginal narrowing of the gap, but it's still quite large. But that's mainly because men have done pretty badly. And a lot of the jobs that this is where Scotland is a bit distinctive from other parts of the country, in that in the last 10 years, there has been jobs growth, and indeed we have a record high level of employment in Scotland, but it is much of the jobs growth has been part-time, much more heavily weighted towards part-time jobs than is the case south of the border, where many of the jobs that have been created are have been full-time jobs. So that, you know, that may have helped women in particular. I don't know the answer to that, but overall there has been a marginal narrowing that's largely been because men have done fairly badly and their real pay is lower in 2016 than it was in 2008.
May I ask Emma, unless you were going to say something on this?
On whether or not there's a correlation between the gender pay gap and the GDP, that's not something that we looked at.
Could I ask you a separate question then, just mm-hmm. quickly? Your report has been widely exposed, commented on, and quoted here as well. Have there been any academic or professional criticisms or critiques about your methodology, your processes, your results that you believe have any merit?
Well, we have had, as part of our McKinsey Global Institute, we have academic advisors who help us with the methodology, and I'd be happy to share the names of those academic advisors afterwards. I don't have them off the top of my head.
Well, out with your grouping.
Well, certainly the academic advisors that we have been quite thorough in looking at our modelling. So we've had academic advisors from Harvard, Harvard Business School, and economists largely from the US. We've also had a number from the UK who specialise in gender economics, who have given us substantial feedback on the methodology that we've done. We've not had large amounts of criticism outside of that process, but we believe that we've engaged with the academic community to ensure that we've got a robust model that, you know, stands up to some academic scrutiny.
And are you updating your model, or does it stand as it is?
So it stands as it is mm-hmm. for the moment, and whether or not we update it it depends on our research programme. We haven't got any plans so far.
Thank you. Move on now to Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. My question has largely been covered, so let me ask a question about a number of different policy areas, because the evidence we've heard today suggests that the matter, or the question of gender pay gap, cuts across a number of policy areas: education, social issues, the economy, public-private sector, childcare. So I'd like to get your views on, other countries have also experienced the gender pay gap. I'd like to get your views on what best practice other countries have adopted in terms of policy or measures to address gender pay, whether you have seen best practice in other countries to address this. I think the University of Stirling evidence looks at the Norway approach to quotas and suggests that that's perhaps not been massively effective. So I'd just like to open it to the panel to see what you've seen in terms of best practice in other countries.
Yes, so the Norway approach, which has actually been emulated in a number of other countries since then, is to mandate that a certain percentage of corporate boards be made up of women. And because this was implemented a good 10 years ago, there has been evaluation of that policy that's been done. And what's been shown quite robustly is that the policy was very effective, because it was a mandatory policy of increasing the diversity on boards, not only in terms of gender, but also in terms of age diversity and experience diversity on corporate boards, which is seen to be a very positive thing. But there was no trickle-down effects of that policy. So it was not the case that we saw that, for instance, that there was an increase in female representation in courses, or even at different management levels throughout big companies.
Yep.
Other countries, we looked at what had happened in Sweden and compared that with the UK and the USA. So the UK and the USA, probably characterised by very free labour markets, fairly low regulation, and we've seen the pay gap narrow for both of them. But interestingly, in Sweden, where the pay gap is much less, it actually doesn't seem to have changed all that much in recent years. And you know, they have a lot of very progressive policies in terms of women's access to the labour market, but there still seems to be a reluctance, well, a finding that is similar to what the kind of thing that we've been describing for Scotland, in that having children is an important has an important effect on levels of subsequent levels of pay, I guess that's one of the other exemplars that we've got.
So we looked at seven different areas in terms of how the gender participation in the economy could be improved. They were women in leadership, women in STEM, childcare and unpaid care work, women in entrepreneurship, women in politics, violence against women and social attitudes. And we looked at, particularly in women in leadership, we tended to look at individual company practices rather than between different companies, between different countries. And I can talk about a few of those if that's interesting. To pick out a couple where we looked at where the UK differed from other countries, women in STEM is a really interesting one, in that we have an awful lot of women who study medicine and biological sciences in the UK, but we have a very small number of women that study computer sciences and engineering and whatnot. And that is quite unique in Europe. We do a lot worse in the UK than in Europe. We have girls dropping out of mathematical and science and technology subjects much earlier than in other countries. And so that's an area where there's potentially things to learn from our European colleagues. In women in entrepreneurship, that's an area actually where the UK has been doing reasonably well, and we're ranked fifth in the world on the Dell Global Women in Entrepreneurship Leadership Scale. There are still things that we could learn. For example, if we were able to match the rate of women in entrepreneurship as they do in the US, there is quite a substantial economic uplift that the UK could experience. So there's potentially things that we can learn from the US, particularly around women in entrepreneurship. I think in childcare, you know, the other panelists have spoken about childcare a little bit. What we would note about childcare is that in the UK, 33% of incomes go on childcare, compared to an OECD average of 13%. And in Scotland, it's a little bit less, but not far behind. I think there are things that the UK could perhaps look at in terms of both encouraging equality of parental care from other countries, encouraging equality of parental leave, and also looking at what can be done in order to make childcare more affordable for parents, and parents, not just women.
Thank you.
John Mason.
Thanks. Yeah, it was to follow up Dean Lockhart's point about, especially about Sweden. I have to say, when I read the report, I was quite surprised that with, I think, UK and US pay gap about 17%, the comparable figure for Sweden is 14%. Which I was certainly surprised about. And one of the lines in your report, it says, still women are concentrated in fewer occupations than men. This partly stems from gender-biased selection of school subjects. So again, I'm surprised. I thought Sweden had, you know, everybody's just equal and choosing the same subjects, but clearly they're not. Have you looked at that at all?
So we haven't looked at that within Sweden, but we did look within Scotland. And this is following on from Emma's point. We see in Scotland that representation in STEM hires, for instance, is broadly equal until you go and drill down into the individual subject choices. And I was very, very surprised to find that, for instance, mathematics is approximately 50-50. But then women are heavily overrepresented, young women, heavily overrepresented in biology, and boys are much likely to go and do physics. And these, given that these are facilitating subjects to university degrees, potentially, this leads to more young men taking engineering in university. So in one way, these choices that young people are making at school looking at age 15 insofar as which subjects they're accusing can actually channel them into different career choices.
So, I mean, I guess it does raise the question about whether we should be allowing a choice out of STEM entirely, at a certain level in school. That might be something that could be looked at.
I also think it's important to say that this is not because girls are not good at STEM subjects. So it's an English statistic, it's not a Scottish one, apologies for that, but half of boys with an A star at GCSE in physics will go on to do it at A level, but only a fifth of girls will. So it's not because girls don't get an A star that they don't then go on to do physics in further education, it's that they're choosing not to. And the Girl Guides did some really interesting research that showed that 80% of girls say they have no STEM role models and 30% expect that they'll have sexism in a STEM career, and therefore why should they choose those subjects? So there's definitely something to be done much earlier than when we get into the workplace to address girls' choices early in life.
I mean, there's also a question of where, when these preferences are formed by girls, and they're formed prior to making these choices. I mean, I think one great idea, which is to make Lego bricks in the colour of pink to encourage small children to be making things, and that might have an impact of them going into engineering. But what I mean by that is making these subjects more female friendly. Until relatively recently, many of the economics textbooks were written very much with the examples being Fred goes to his local store, and that has changed in the last 5 to 10 years, I would have said. And with in certain subjects, you may argue that there are ways for them to be taught in a manner that is more accessible for young girls to pique their interest.
Would that apply the other way around as well? I was at a visit to an organisation called Men in Childcare, and the feedback that we received was that it wasn't so much that there was a difficulty with men finding jobs in that sort of area, but more a lack of men coming forward to do that. And what we were told is partly because there's very few male role models, for example, in early years education or sort of nursery education. So would that apply both ways rather than just to women?
Yeah, it certainly could. I think the Royal Society of Edinburgh has tried very hard to make sure that, you know, there are female role model scientists out there and communicating with the educational establishment. It's certainly true that in some occupations men choose not to enter, and probably for the same kind of reason, the lack of role model being possibly one of those that causes them not to go into the, there are very few men in the care sector as well.
Thank you. And now a couple of questions, one from Gil Patterson and then Ash Denham.
Question. I need to declare an interest. I have a 16-year-old girl who is just studying for her highers at present time. So my question is, who is it that fills the pipeline? Is it the school, the young person, or the parents?
That's an absolutely great question, because at the moment, I looked into this and I was actually surprised and pleasantly surprised by the number of programs that were available in order to help young people choose the subjects that they were going to go and do. But there seem to be these programs seem to be based in the different education institutions, so in primary versus secondary, and then universities do a lot of outreach. There's a question though there that, you know, by the time young people are making their choices about their hires, it's potentially their preferences are already formed, so it potentially needs to be done at a younger age. Whether that's primary school, whether that's parents.
Yeah. You know, and again, role models, and of course, teachers are really, really important role models, and training teachers to be clear about the opportunities that are available, given the choices that pupils might make, seems to me to be another area of policy that could be looked at.
I think there's also something about broader society, the depiction of women and men in media more broadly. How often do we see women experts or male experts on childcare speaking in the media, for example? And an interesting piece of survey research from the Fawcett Society, back to your question, convener, was that 76% of girls and 59% of boys say they would be interested in a non-traditional work sector if they were given the opportunity, which does suggest that it's equally relevant for boys as it is for girls. Being able to, you can't be what you can't see. So I think the importance of role models in schools and by parents and also broadly in the media, I think, is really important.
Okay, thanks for that. Thank you.
I was going to ask about the unexplained component in your work, Dr. Wilson and Professor Bell, and also about STEM, but I think we've covered those two areas now. So if I could just move on, there's this idea about women returning to work after a break, maybe, having sort of fairly high levels of education and experience, and then opting to work part-time and probably below their skill and experience level. Can we put a number on that in terms of the amount lost to the economy by women sort of persistently working below their skills and experience?
Monica.
So I believe the other written evidence may have, so they were talking specifically about that. I'm not sure whether there was a number assigned to that, so that's not something that we specifically looked at. However, the point made that, like, women, when returning after a career break, are essentially not utilising their full talents, or taking a job which does not utilise their full talents, does imply a brain drain, so to say, there's an untapped resource there that could be more useful. To the extent that it appears, and we have a graph that looks at the reasons why individuals work part-time, and overwhelmingly because they chose to work part-time. To the extent that this choice is determined not at an individual level, at a household level, that it may be socially conditioned, or it may be, just for whatever reason, easier for one partner to return to the to stay in the full time in the labour force, and the other partner to go in part time. And historically, it has been, and it continues to be, that generally it's the mother who returns part time.
Yeah, I mean, we do make the point in the paper, and there are very subtle things that we can't pick up either in terms of education or experience, but the point we make in the paper is about commuting, and the fact that women are probably, that the evidence does suggest, less willing to do a long commute, which means that the choices of jobs that are available to them are more limited, and then that will have consequences for pay and so on. And the decision about the commute is almost certainly related to caring for children or other social responsibilities that they're taking on, which is, as Tanya was saying, a household decision.
I mean, a couple of things that might help with that question. The IPPR did an estimate that said that if 300,000 more mothers with children under five worked, it could raise 1.5 billion in tax credits. So that gives you some estimate. That was the only estimate that we came across. I think the point is well made, though, about women's or families' choices. 29% of women report returning to work post a baby is financially unviable. And when you have women earning less than men, then as a household, it becomes a reasonably sensible economic decision to have the woman forego paid work if it is unaffordable for the family to afford both childcare and both parents to go out to work.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Now we'll come on to a question from Jackie Bailey.
Isabel touched on this in response to Bill Bowman, but I wonder whether I could tease it out a little bit further, and that's the reduction in the gender pay gap in Scotland, largely down to a decline in male earnings. Can I ask firstly, is that true for the rest of the UK? And if it is true for the rest of the UK, is the kind of gap in Scotland closing by more than the rest of the UK as a result of an increased decline in male earnings, or is there something else going on?
So that's requires me to go into the recesses of my memory.
Take your time.
Well, one thing to say is that the gender pay gap, I think, in Scotland is somewhat less than in the UK as a whole, and I principally put that down to the fact that, particularly among males, there are far fewer very high earners, and the very high earners affect the mean, and the comparison is done, well, the mean, a lot of comparisons are done using the mean. Now, another factor is that we point out in the paper is the difference in the size of the public sector, and it isn't, I don't think it's massively much larger in Scotland. It is somewhat larger. It is slightly better paid. It used to be quite a lot better paid. It's only slightly better paid, and there is a concentration of women in public sector jobs. So that's another explanation of the difference in the gender pay gap in Scotland and England. Now, I'm trying to recall what... So public sector pay having been held back on both sides of the border probably is fairly neutral in terms of the gender pay gap. Our evidence does show a slight closing.
Yeah. And we do see that the difference between female wages between Scotland and the UK is 6% in favour of Scottish work, Scottish women compared to women in West UK, whereas men in Scotland, and this is the most latest figures, are paid around 2% less. Their wages are around 2% less than the West UK figures. So not only is the gender gap slightly smaller in Scotland, and women in particular seem to be faring better in Scotland as compared to the West UK.
And I think the thing about men is particularly around the lack of very high earners.
Okay. I don't know if Emma Gibbs wants to add anything to that.
I don't have anything to add. We didn't look at this in particular.
No. Okay. Can I then put two scenarios to you? Because the last published quarter's GDP figures showed negative growth, and indeed some commentators have described it as being on the brink of a recession. Mm-hmm. Do you see the pay gap closing as a result of that, given that there is likely to be a further depression, certainly in male earnings? And conversely, if the economy grows, do you see actually the perverse outcome, which would be the pay gap widens? I'm just curious as to how you would model those two scenarios.
Yeah, so, I mean, a principal cause, it seems to me, of the relative slowing of the Scottish economy relative to the rest of the UK over the last 3 or 4 years is the decline in the oil industry. Now, that is a massively male-oriented industry. And as a result of that, you would probably expect the pay gap to narrow. So in those circumstances, actually, the economy slowing would result in a smaller pay gap. The other sector, another sector which is probably doing less well, is the financial services, I'm not quite sure, because that's much more gender balanced, what effect that will have on the gender pay gap. Again, I suspect that at higher levels it's still a male dominated industry. So does that help?
I suppose what I'm driving at is, you know, the pay gap closing mm-hmm. in the context of a slowdown in the economy isn't necessarily a good thing, because the overall economy has suffered. And therefore the trick for us as policymakers is, in the context of a growing economy, which is what we all want to achieve, it's how you then close that pay gap at the same time.
And if I might add, in many ways that's the angle Absolutely. That we're coming from, in saying, rather than how does the economy grow and mm-hmm. how does that impact men and women, how can you use women's increased participation in the economy in order to help the economy grow by putting more skilled workers into the sectors and the parts of the economy where there are skill shortages.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. And Richard Leonard.
Yeah, I'd like to follow up Jackie Bailey's line of inquiry, in the sense that in the public sector, we've had pay guidelines now for as long as I can remember anyway. And I wonder whether that's played a part at the bottom end, where there has been, for example, accommodation for a living wage to be introduced, whether at the bottom end that's led to a closure of the gap amongst those working people. So I suppose the first part of my question to all of you really is, what more could be done with the design of the public sector pay guidelines to further improve on the closure of the gap in the public sector? And my second question is something which explicitly comes up in the Tanya Wilson, David Bell paper, which is about the Scottish Business Pledge, which is a voluntary mechanism, of course, but contains moral suasion, I think is the expression which you use, which takes me back to my economics days at Stirling University. But anyway, but it talks about a voluntary principle. I mean, if there was more, if there was a tougher regime or some kind of conditionality attached to help from Scottish enterprise or access to regional selective assistance or inclusion in public procurement, is the scope there to use that as a lever to try to put pressure in the private sector to close the gender pay gap there?
I'll just answer that last point. I thought there was that the Scottish Government was making some assistance conditional on meeting the business pledge. It's an interesting point about public procurement, because that's an area that may well emerge during the after the first part of the Brexit deal is done, when the trade negotiations are in full swing. Public procurement will probably be one of the areas that will be looked at in any trade deal that we do with the States or with Canada or so on. So then a question may arise as to what power to influence the shape of public procurement might exist post-Brexit. So that was your last point.
Just on the public procurement point, we looked at the impact that government preference for SMEs had had in increasing the number of SMEs that are taking part in public tenders and whatnot, and so did have a question about whether or not there was an opportunity to encourage more women entrepreneurs and women SMEs through guidelines related to public procurement. So that could be quite an interesting one. I think the other area that we would say in terms of encouraging progress in the private sector, you know, we talk a lot in our report about the need for targets and public reporting against targets. Now, those targets might be set by the companies themselves, but there is something very powerful about saying this is what we're going to do, and we're now going to transparently track against what we're going to do to ensure that we're making progress. Partly to ensure you make progress and put some focus on it, but also partly because that focuses the mind on what's really working, and measuring what's working, and therefore increasing investment in the the things that are working, and not just carrying on with lots of little things that might not be working, but you know, you're just able to say you're doing a lot. So I think that's an area that we think has a lot of power. And again, you see with something like the Davies report, where you had a particular target for the number of women on boards, that did actually have quite a big impact in terms of the shift in the number of women on boards. So there is a role for that kind of setting of targets and reporting against them. In terms of your question about the public sector, what our research notes is that the public sector is one of the few sectors in the UK economy where women are well represented throughout the pipeline of seniority. And so in many respects, you know, we are looking to the public sector to say, what has the public sector done that the rest of the economy can learn from in terms of being able to have lots of women coming into the pipeline and then keeping them in the pipe and progressing them through to senior levels. Some of what we see that the public sector has done has been very good on flexible working schemes, not just introducing them, but making sure people take them up and that they don't have a penalty for doing so, making sure that men and women can take them up equally so that it doesn't become flexible working becomes another woman penalty, but rather it is something that is there for both sexes to benefit from and to enjoy. And we also see that there's been that there's very good progress in helping people with breaks from work, returning from work, and whatnot. So from our perspective, there's a lot that the rest of the economy can learn from the public sector.
So I was going to go and add that there's legislation which I believe, takes place from April of 2018, where large firms are going to be required, and this is large firms with over 250 employees, are going to have to report a number of statistics each year regarding their pay. So the gender pay gap at the mean and the median, as well as in bonus pay and the ratio of males and females receiving bonuses. And insofar as Emma was saying, having these statistics available and having greater transparency and having targets is a great thing. These ones are the ones that firms are required to provide. There is the case for saying, well, instead of just looking at the gender pay gap at the mean, at the median, well, let's look at it at different career points, at entry level, at mid management, at upper management, to ensure that that pay equality is achieved throughout the career progression, and also by making transparent what policies are being undertaken to ensure that the promotion from entry level to mid-management level are broadly equal between both men and women. These type of policies that do not require legislation but can be done within, for instance, the business pledge on a voluntary scheme are the type of policies that might actually, policies may actually gain traction in making substantial improvements.
That's a very optimistic view, I think, isn't it, of transparency as the disinfectant that will flush out all these inequalities. We shall wait and see. To Emma Gibbs, would it be possible for you to share with us some of those examples? Because the evidence that we've heard this morning seems to suggest that there is an issue around women taking time off for maternity reasons and returning and returning part-time and therefore having lower wages and less access to career opportunities. If you've got examples in the public sector that you harvested, it would be really useful for this committee, I think, to see examples of that.
We did look at the NHS in a bit of detail, so I'd be happy to share, rather than wade through it all now, I'd be happy to share that with you outside. We also have some good examples of where private sector organisations have taken some quite bold steps, and particularly in STEM, interestingly, a couple of big firms that have taken some really good steps to improve not just getting women in the bottom of the pipe, but progressing them all the way through the pipe. So I'd be happy to share those with you outside of the committee.
Has there, in those examples, been any analysis done on the effect that it's had on, for example, profit-making companies on the bottom line, maybe how it's improved you know, we're finding it very difficult to come up with examples of where it's actually improved a business case, because I think that's really important in encouraging other businesses to voluntarily take these measures.
Yes, absolutely. Well, you won't be surprised that we look at that quite a lot, because obviously that's something that our clients are interested in. And the research that we most recently did was in our Diversity Matters report, which was released in 2015 or the beginning of 16. And in that, we looked at Europe, and we also looked at the US, and we looked at the UK. And in the UK, what we see is that for a 10% increase in gender diversity on an executive board, we see a statistically significant correlation with an uplift of earnings before interest and taxation of 3.5%. So previous research we've done has shown a correlation between increased diversity in boards and increased diversity in senior management teams and total return to shareholders. And in this piece of research, we were able to demonstrate a statistically significant increase with earnings before interest and tax when you increase the diversity, particularly of the executive board, which I think is really compelling. Yeah. Honestly, it's really compelling evidence. And again, I'd be very happy to share a copy of that research with you. And you know, when we looked at it, it wasn't just that was a global figure; that was specifically for the UK. So it's something which we can kind of prove for the UK.
Thank you. In terms of the Norway case, where I spoke about earlier, there has been certain research that's done that's looked at the profitability of firms after the quota was introduced. And there was no significant impact on firm profitability or market share. So there was no adverse effect, but there was no large improvement, but there was definitely no adverse effect of diversifying the corporate board.
I also think it's worth us making a distinction between the executive committee and the board, because we often talk about the board, and that's an area where we've made an awful lot of progress, particularly through the Davis report and whatnot. Executive committees typically have, so at the moment in the UK we have 25% of boards are women, but 17% of executive committees are women, so it's lower. And in our research in Diversity Matters, we saw a stronger correlation between women being on an executive committee than we did on the board. Now there's plenty of other research that shows a correlation, not necessarily in Norway, but in Europe, that shows a correlation between more women on the board and better financial performance. But particularly in the executive committee, we've seen this statistical correlation.
But the board's only one aspect of a company. I mean, are you looking at the profitability of a company where there's actually been gender mechanisms put in place to encourage diversity throughout the entire organisation?
So for Diversity Matters, we looked at the executive committees and the top leadership, and so we looked across the whole sample, I think, at about 5,000 different leaders in across organisations. And again, I can share the research with you afterwards. So we didn't penetrate all the way down through an organisation because we were looking at publicly available data, and that a lot of that data is not available. However, what we have done in our Women Matter research, and again, I can share this with you, is look at We have survey data of organisations that are implementing lots of different initiatives, and we look at how many women they have in their senior executive positions and on their boards, and we put them into different quartiles, and then we look at the relative financial performance. And there again, we do see that those who are in the top quartile in terms of the number and the extent of the initiatives that they've put in and the nature of the initiatives that they've put in and their performance in terms of having women in their senior management and having women on their boards, we do see that those in that top quartile perform better financially than those in the bottom. Now again, it's a correlation, it's not a causation. There are a number of reasons why that we can hypothesize, if you like, about why that correlation exists. But that's quite a strong measure of not just at the top, because you're absolutely right, it's not just about the top, it's about the pipeline all the way through, rather than simply parachuting people in at the top where you maybe don't have a very good pipeline yourself.
That would be really useful to look at that.
Yes, we can share that afterwards. Yeah.
Right, thank you. I have a question I want to ask, and this goes back to the, I think, possibly the University of Stirling Research, but no doubt Emma Gibbs will have possibly comment to make as well. It's about the difficulty of equating reduction of gender pay gap with greater economic growth, and indeed this follows on from what Gillian Martin was asking about. And I think, Professor Bell, you've already alluded to this in terms of, you know, if a meal is prepared at home, it's not taken into account in the data. If it's done in a restaurant, then it is. And, I mean, I'm just wondering if I could add to this slightly. If we think in terms of, I'm a member of the cross-party group on volunteering. So there are lots of people in Scotland and other countries that do voluntary work for which they're not paid in monetary terms in the third sector. And even on a private level, many individuals will undertake caring responsibilities within the home and so forth. Now, none of that is necessarily accounted for in economic data. And sometimes it's not about simply transferring. I think we talked about transfer of workers and so forth previously. But an example from my own professional experience, in the courthouses across Scotland, we have people who serve tea and coffee to people who come to the courthouses. Now, I think historically these were colloquially referred to as the tea ladies, mainly it was women who did that as volunteers, although it wasn't just women, it was also men. Now, my understanding is now these people are paid rather than being volunteers. So effectively, the same thing is being done, but the individuals providing the service are now paid in monetary terms. So they would now come within the statistics, whereas historically they didn't. But actually, there's no difference in terms of the work being done. And of course, many women or women have always worked and worked very hard, but it didn't mean they received a salary in terms of waged employment or money. So how does this fit together in terms of looking at the economy? Some comments on that, perhaps.
So I guess your argument would be very helpful to those who would suggest, and I probably agree, that GDP doesn't measure everything, you know, and we shouldn't focus on it entirely as a measure of our economic and indeed social health. There are areas where the interaction of unpaid tasks and paid tasks are nevertheless very, very important. And one in particular that you sort of alluded to is unpaid care. So we've done quite a lot of research on this. I've forgotten there are about 500,000 unpaid carers in Scotland, mainly women, but not entirely women. And the fact that, you know, that their activity gets no credit in terms of annual GDP, but we are given that the need for care is likely to increase in the future, particularly concerned about whether there's substitution between paid care and unpaid care, just as we in my example, I was talking about substitution between a meal in a restaurant and a meal at home. The fact is that if all of the unpaid carers decided no longer to provide care, the NHS and the social care system in Scotland would be in deep crisis. There are various ways of trying to value the provision that unpaid carers make, and I'm happy to supply you with details of that. But I think at the end of the day, what this suggests is that focusing just on GDP as your measure of economic health is inadequate. That's why we've seen a lot of attention given to alternative ways of looking at national well-being, being one of them. Gus O'Donnell in the Cabinet Office has done a whole lot of work on this, and you know, these measures are somewhat more fuzzy than GDP, which can where there's many books which explain to you how to calculate GDP in a particular country. But nevertheless, it isn't the be-all and shouldn't be seen as the be-all and end-all of measuring economic and indeed social health.
Yes, I mean, just to follow in on what you're saying, obviously what someone is paid in monetary terms is something that we can quantify. So it's understandable that people do try and focus on that, at least to a certain extent. Of course, this is also the Fair Work Committee. So, as you say, there are other factors that come into play. And I'm just wondering if there is a question about the desirability of focusing purely on an economic, a monetary factor and numbers. Now, I'm not criticising economists for focusing on numbers at all, and I understand you approach things from a certain way, but I'm wondering if you would accept there may be a question about the desirability of focusing solely on numbers, particularly if this one is going on beyond what Dr. Wilson was talking about, the question of equal pay for the same work, and going beyond and looking at overall lifetime calculations of pay.
I wouldn't use the term numbers. I would use the term markets. So what GDP does is it's quite good at aggregating up all the activity that we've got in markets where prices are paid and exchange takes place. What economists actually do, I don't want to undermine my profession, is spend quite a lot of time on trying to value things that are not traded in a market. You know, that might be things to do with the environment, might be things to do with caring or whatever. So it's not to say that economists are unaware of this, and it is an extremely big issue. I guess, you know, there is a lot of debate going on within economics about the extent of the focus on measurable stuff. Many economists in the city don't think of anything else but measurable stuff. But a broader view of activity in the economy, broadly defined, has to take account of the kinds of activity that maybe isn't traded in a market, but nevertheless is valuable.
Yeah, sorry, Emma Gibbs.
I think we would agree with that, and one of the things that we note in our report is that we don't put a figure on, for example, unpaid care work that people choose to do, and that's an enormously important aspect that is difficult to measure, which is why we don't measure it. There are a couple of other things, though, that I think are interesting to the debate, which you can measure that are not monetary. Our recent research did a survey of men and women in the workplace across Europe, and it showed that women and men have equal levels of ambition for promotion, getting to the next level or getting to the top of their organisations. Women are half as likely to believe it is possible for them to get there, which is a really important measure of aspiration and people's sense of being able to fulfil their aspirations. And equally, a third of men and women feel that their careers are going to interfere with their life as parents or their roles as family, their roles within their families or indeed their outside interests. So again, there's really important measures there about quality of life and how it pertains to men and women in their working environments, in their professional lives and also in their personal lives, which I think does play to your point that it's not just about GDP numbers. There are also some really important issues within this debate which are about personal fulfilment, both in work and also outside of work.
Thank you. And perhaps coming to Dr. Wilson, because I think you possibly touched on this, I'm just wondering about the concept of extra hours worked, which are not necessarily the contracted 4 hours, so one might be on a contract for 40 hours. And I think probably in a lot of workplaces, what one does in addition to what one is contracted for may have an effect on promotion. And I'm just wondering how that is brought into the equation, because many women and many men obviously work hours beyond what they've agreed to in terms of the requirements of their workplace. particularly probably in the private sector. And I'm just wondering how your data, your approach to this captures that and how that can be brought into account and how that plays, interplays with all this.
I can do something.
Yes, I think you should. So
I wrote a paper many years ago with a colleague, Bob Hart, on unpaid work. And actually, the Labour Force Survey does ask people what their contractual hours are and how many hours they actually work. So situation, I think, trying to recall, definitely men work more hours, and your rationale for doing this may be the correct one, that it's they want to signal to employers that they're ready to be promoted. We went to Germany and presented this paper, and they couldn't understand what we were talking about because they don't do unpaid work. You know, work and non-work, and this is true of many continental countries, are very clearly defined. In the UK, we've kind of let work slip into a much larger proportion of the week, and we justify so doing for all kinds of reasons, and we just don't take this hard line of saying, okay, I'm finished, it's 5 o'clock, I'm off to play a game of golf. You know, that's the that is a pretty important distinction that has certainly got implications for the gender pay gap. It seems to me is that the culture here in the UK is somewhat different in terms of the way that working hours are regulated.
We pick this up a little bit when we talk about women and networking and women and sponsorship, that quite a bit of this extra work is to do with building those network relationships and those sponsorship relationships which help you move through an organisation. And women are just not as adept at making those relationships and making those sponsorship connections on their own than men, and they have been shown to be really critical to advancement and promotion. So one of the areas that certainly we talk a lot about within how you get women more into managerial and leadership positions, particularly in light of care and responsibilities, but also career breaks and whatnot. You know, we talk about how can organisations help make sure that women have those sponsorship and network connections that they might not naturally form, and indeed how can you create a culture within an organisation where it doesn't need to take place always out of hours for either men or women, that you can create those connections within the organisation during work time that will enable people to advance.
Perhaps I can come full circle then. In these other countries, is the emphasis perhaps less on money and more on the general work package and therefore a different culture? Is that part of it possible?
Well, I recall recently, and it's mere recall of a newspaper article about how work-life balance in Denmark is much, well, you could say more favourable, but there is clearly a time for work and clearly a time for other things, much more so than is the case in the UK, and that was felt to be one of the causes why Denmark is always close to the top of the world well-being scores in terms of how happy people are with their with the way that they're living.
Okay. Well, I don't know if Dr. Wilson, you would like the final word here today, perhaps.
No, I'm fine. I don't have anything more to add.
Right. Well, that's fine. Thank you very much to all of our witnesses today. I'll suspend the session to move into the second panel. Thank you for coming in. Well, good morning and welcome back to this meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. For our second panel today, we have two people. First of all, Charles Cotton, who is the Policy Advisor of Pay and Reward and is here on behalf of the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development. And secondly, Maggie Morrison, who is Vice President of the Public Sector CGI Scotland and a board member for, and I think here representing the Scottish Chambers of Commerce. So welcome to both of you. Thank you for coming in today. We'll start off with a question from Gillian Martin.
I was afraid you were going to say that. I'm just looking for my question. Right. Just give me a second. Right. I'm ready. I'm ready. Yeah. We've been asking everyone that's come in front of us about statistics. And I wonder if you both give us your opinion on whether we've actually got a defined set of agreed statistics on female economic activity in Scotland that we can actually draw any conclusions from.
Well, I suppose it depends on the questions you're asking, so I don't think you can rely on measures, necessarily any one measure. So the median figure, as you've probably heard in other evidence, can be seen as more representative because it's actually what people get, whilst the mean can also be seen as representative in that it kind of takes into account people at either extremes of the pay distribution, and women tend to be at the lower end whilst men are at the higher end. So as an organisation, the CIPD has a gender pay gap of around 14% at the mean and 7% at the median, which shows that we have a skew towards the higher end for men. If our chief executive was to become a woman, then the mean would fall from 14 to around 7%. So it kind of shows you how those figures can vary. But obviously there are other statistics or data that influence these statistics. So for instance, how children are encouraged into certain careers at school. I read the latest survey from the Halifax Building Society, which showed that boys get 13% more in terms of pocket money than girls in the UK. And there's been research carried out in the States that looks at identical products which are marketed to men and women differently. So things like shampoo can be 48% more expensive for women to purchase, even though they've got similar ingredients, whilst shower gel and other similar products can cost as much as 56%. Now, I'm not suggesting you perhaps go to your local supermarket and start buying things from the men's section, but it would be quite interesting to see why there are those kind of variations as well. So it's not just what's going on in the workplace, but it's also what's going around in wider society as well.
I'm smiling because I'm thinking about the amount of money that my daughter extracts from me, and I'm now repackaging it in my head as her doing her bit for feminism, because she certainly manages to extract an awful lot more than me and her brother does. But Maggie, have you got any thoughts on this?
I don't really have any specific statistics, and I don't think anything that you wouldn't have heard already, you know, like women taking on 76% of care responsibility, more likely to be in low-paid, low-skilled jobs. And fewer women in the sector. I work in my day job in IT and technology, but I don't have any specific statistics with me.
There's the CIPD is doing more work on work on the EHRC and maternity discrimination, and I wonder if it's an opportunity for you to discuss how that's going at the moment and what you're looking into there.
Well, we're supporting the campaign, perhaps unsurprising. We've got the moral case. We believe it's the right thing to do. But also as a profession, 70% of our members are female. And we're using this as a route to kind of help them challenge perhaps assumptions or misconceptions among male colleagues in their organisations. Sometimes I think businesses can get so focused on focusing on things like the business or profitability, that sometimes they forget, well, actually, that the people within the organisation are the means by which they achieve these ends. And therefore, if you are inclusive and try and meet their needs as much as you can, then that can bring benefits to the organisation as well.
Because there's quite a lot of anecdotal evidence from women. I mean, speak to most women who've had children, and they'll have stories around how they feel that they've been discriminated against when maybe either they came back to work or when they actually divulged to their work that they were actually expecting a baby and were have to take some time off. I mean, how are you gathering that kind of evidence around that so you can tackle all of these issues that might not actually be on record, but certainly are the experience of an awful lot of women?
Well, we have been doing research working with SMEs in the city of Glasgow, helping them deal with HR issues. They don't, obviously being small and very small, don't have the HR capability themselves. So we have our members who are helping them with that and kind of explaining them see them that just because a woman falls pregnant doesn't mean the business is going to kind of come to an end, and actually you can start thinking flexibly about how you deal with that, and how if you are able to show commitment to those individuals, and they're going to show commitment back to you as an organisation. So I think, again, it's, as I said earlier, challenging conceptions and misconceptions around what the impact's going to be. And just encouraging our members to show organisations the importance of treating people who do become pregnant fairly, and especially now, it's not the assumption is it always has been that it's going to be women who take the time off, but increasingly it's now men, and you may have a gay male couple who are now going to be thinking about which one of them is going to be taking time off to if they adopt a child.
Quite a lot of this discrimination is actually subconscious.
Yes.
And so what are you doing to with your members to actually get them to identify maybe where they maybe have subconsciously discriminated, and that has an effect on...
Again, it's trying to kind of raise awareness about the issues as you said about the problem about subconsciousness. You're not always aware of it, so you're kind of trying to raise awareness of why you may have these kind of feelings and what you can do about them. But obviously, it varies not only by by size of organisation, but it can also vary by sector.
Are you able to give me any examples?
I'll have to get back to you on that, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Now a question from Jackie Bailey.
We'll be aware of the forthcoming pay gap legislation. I'd be interested in your view on it and whether you think that will actually have an effect and close the pay gap.
I think it's very positive. I think it's a welcome first step in achieving a degree of transparency on what's going on. And I think we touched on unconscious bias there. A number of organisations do carry out unconscious bias training, because on the previous question, I think it's quite difficult to collect statistics on what is essentially a missed opportunity because you were discriminated against because you were female, or you weren't. It's not even, I find, women who become pregnant. I have seen it happen where a woman has been passed over for promotion because she's of childbearing age and might become pregnant and leave the business. So I think that makes it all very difficult. Also in this area, I don't think organisations sometimes where there is a bias in pay or promotion or bonus actually recognise that. And I think this legislation, while it's not the whole answer, is a really welcome first step, because I actually think some organisations might be surprised themselves when they look at the data that's produced.
Okay, Mr. Cotton.
Yes, the CIPD welcomes the legislation. I think what's going to be important is what organisations do about it. Are they going to have an action plan in place? Think about the gender pay gap. is that whilst it all, you know, kind of identifies issues internally within an organisation, but it also kind of throws up issues that are external as well. So why aren't potentially women going into certain professions and joining the organisation? The issue around affordable childcare. These can often be outside what an organisation identifies as being something that they can deal with. That said, there's nothing to stop organisations clubbing together with similar ones to go out to schools and try and encourage people to go into what's perceived as being historically male-dominated professions. And similarly, it's not just about getting more females into male professions, but also more males into female professions as well, to kind of break down those kind of stereotypes. And also around the language as well, I think that's going to be important as well. When employees start looking at the gender pay gap, they're going to, well, what's the difference between the mead and the median? Is the employer trying to kind of confuse us? Is there some kind of hidden agenda there? So I think it's also going to be quite important about how organisations and also government explains why there are these different measures of measuring the pay gaps.
So they're going to get that idea. Some of my colleagues will explore the policy areas with you later. I just want to home in on the pay gap legislation just now. I'm conscious that the Scottish economy is typically driven by small to medium-sized enterprises, and therefore they fall below the threshold of 250 employees. I'd kind of welcome an assessment of how prepared you think employers are currently that have over 250 employees, and whether you'd welcome an extension of this reporting to small to medium-sized enterprises as well.
I would. I think it would, because Scotland, I can't remember the exact percentage, but it's 98.something% SME or of that order. And so I think it would be helpful to extend that to small to medium businesses. Okay. I'd also like to reinforce Charles' point on the stuff that affects this that organisations don't see within their remit necessarily, such as childcare. Mm.
Mr. Compton?
I mean, I suppose if you were to try and, if the gender pay gap legislation had come in about 10, 15 years ago, it would have been far more challenging for organisations because they wouldn't have had the information capability to kind of generate the information that is required now. So I think many companies should have the information systems in place. We also had something called reporting and pay as you earn in real time, which means that lots of organisations had to clear up their payroll data anyway. So I think many of them should be able to do it relatively straightforwardly. Smaller organisations, I think there could be a challenge for some of the smaller ones if they don't see, you know, the business case or why they should be doing it. But I think if they start to see that larger organisations are doing it, and it's not causing them problems, and there may be actually benefits from doing it, then they may see the benefits as well. So what we should be doing is encouraging smaller organisations to adopt gender pay gap reporting as well, and over time review this and see whether there is requirements for legislation to be introduced. If you go to a certain level of size, then you may have issues around data protection and, privacy issues.
But that would be to a very small level?
Yes, to a very small level.
Thank you very much.
Right, thank you. I want to ask a question about what is called the enterprise gap in Scotland, and I think this probably comes from a research by Professor Sarah Carter at Strathclyde University, who suggested that if female business ownership equaled those of men, this would equate to a 32% increase in Scotland's business base. Now, I'm just wondering if you could comment on that, because if one thinks of increasing the number of businesses in the country, would that generate new business, new work, and is that something that either of you or the organisations you represent have thought about how that could be encouraged?
Not from Scottish Chambers' perspective. I'd need to take that away and come back.
Mm-hmm. We have looked at the issue of, you know, encouraging more female entrepreneurship. Again, it can be issues outside as well, which cause the challenge. So if you're in the rural area, you're going to be limited by, for instance, broadband speed and communication issues, which may limit your ability to set up your own business there, not necessarily whether you're a male or a female.
Right, thank you. And now come to a question from Richard Leonard.
Thanks, Convener. I'm sure, like me, every January you rush out to buy the Scottish Business Insider Top 500 magazine. And if you do that, like me, you'll understand that only around 1% of the large companies operating in Scotland are run by women. That, I think that's Women Enterprises statistic. Do you have a view on that? Do you have any sense of the reasons that lie behind that that you could share with us?
I think a lot of this comes back to, well, it's certainly in the industry that I work in, a lot of it comes back to the fact that those industries are dominated by men, by a specific corporate stereotype, for want of a better way of putting it. And as long as that's the case, and we cannot, it's not just about encouraging women in my case into STEM, for example. Once you get them there, you have to keep them there and have them flourish in the environment in which they find themselves. And listening to the evidence earlier, you know, I'm very supportive of mentoring and sponsorship, because I don't believe that women aren't good at these things. I believe it's more difficult for a woman to do that where the natural networks are male networks, and I think that's part of the problem. And I think all that you're seeing in terms of the leadership of big organisations in Scotland being mostly male is that those organisations are mostly male, and that's what's happening. And we do need to have some fundamental change in bringing young women in, encouraging them to stay, supporting them, sponsoring them, and making sure that we can change the gender balance.
Yeah, the CIPD is supportive of there being more women on the board, not only at non-executive level, but also at executive level. And for organisations to think about how they recruit people into an organisation and then promote them up. And again, it's around things such as mentoring programmes, coaching programmes, childcare, again, flexible working arrangements that need to be taken into consideration. But again, it's just challenging, as Maggie said, assumptions. I mean, in the 40s, 50s and 60s, IT was predominantly a female industry. And of course, now you could say it's predominantly male.
There's one facet of large corporate Scotland which I wonder whether it plays a factor or maybe it doesn't. I mean, I take the point about some of those dominant industries like oil and gas and financial services have got quite a lot of kind of men at the top. But one of the features of the Scottish economy at the large end especially is the extent to which it's externally owned and the extent to which it's overseas owned, and therefore the extent to which decision making isn't necessarily taken here. Yeah. Do you think that's a factor or not?
I don't think so, because those organisations, I mean, I work for one, for a company that's French-Canadian and based out of Montreal, but they still need leaders in country, and so I don't think it's... some of those organisations will be more centralised than others. CGI is very matrixed, so it's run like a satellite operation, a satellite business that has to take care of its own profit and loss. But even if that weren't the case, I don't think that makes a difference in whether you appoint a man or a woman to lead, unless there's something in the home, you know, HQ that is reinforcing the idea that there are going to be more men appointed as leaders. I don't think it really is a factor, though.
I mean, yeah, I take the point that you're saying it shouldn't make a difference. I guess my question is, do you think it does make a difference or not?
I don't think so. Okay. I genuinely don't.
Okay. It's not something that has been brought to our attention. No, I mean, as Maggie said, you still need somebody to be in charge of your locality. And why would you want a man over a woman?
Thank you. Ash Denham.
Thank you. Yeah, so following on from that question from Richard Leonard, I guess the next question on that would be that do you think there's enough funding and support for women-owned businesses maybe either starting up or progressing through the enterprise network in Scotland?
I don't know that I can properly answer that question. I mean, the Scottish Chambers does a lot of work, while as far as I'm aware, not specifically around increasing the number of female businesses, which is, I guess, where your question is coming from. The Chambers does do a lot of work in mentoring and support together with Scottish Enterprise and Women Enterprise Scotland. I'm not sure whether more funding would help or if part of the answer is providing the right support to these women through mentoring and sponsorship so that they can see and become role models that it is possible to be a successful female entrepreneur. Because that's another issue that I think we haven't touched on yet, is the women will be encouraged by seeing more successful women. And perhaps more funding and support could help that.
Yes, I'd agree with what Maggie said. It's, to a certain extent, it's around giving the encouragement to go with your dreams. There may be issues of infrastructure where it may be more challenging in certain areas to set your own business up. But I think it's, in the first instance, it's actually giving people the confidence.
Okay, thank you.
Bill Bowman.
Thank you, convener. And we maybe touched a little bit on this in earlier questions, but do you think companies see gender diversity as a high enough business priority? And maybe, depending on your answer, do they perhaps see components of it as important, but don't put it all together into, you know, gender diversity as a concept?
I think that for gender diversity to be really important to an organisation, it has to be really important to the leader of that organisation. And I don't think that's always the case. And I think that the organisations that are successful in terms of increasing female participation and increasing female representation at the highest levels have leaders for whom that is really important, and leaders who will make it clear that it will be part of the fabric of the organisation, of the performance management of the organisation, and really measure it. So if you had asked me, two points, I think. I graduated in 1983, and if you had told me in 2017 that the number of young women entering STEM as a profession would be going backwards, I simply wouldn't have believed that that would be possible in 2017. And also, if you told me then that there would have been not much progress on gender diversity in organisations, I wouldn't have believed that either, because I graduated thinking that things would change. I wouldn't have agreed with quotas and targets then. I do now. And the reason I do now is I've watched not much change in the last 34 years. So if we continue at this pace trying to do what we've always done, I don't think we're going to see much change. And I think leaders really need to lead from the front and believe it. Otherwise, it's just a lot of talk.
Hopefully, the requirement to publish gender pay gap data will act as a catalyst among many leaders to realise the importance of this issue, either from a moral perspective, you know, it's the right thing to do, I wouldn't want my daughter or my sister or my mother to be treated this way, or looking at the business benefits, which have been talked about previously, about how more diverse organisations can have be more successful, or the risk to the reputation of the organisation if you are seen as being a firm that is unfair, then you're going to struggle to sell your goods and services, and you're going to struggle to recruit and retain the talent that you require.
So, I mean, I know tone from the top is important in any organisation, but do you get the impression then that there is not now an importance given to this, even if things you don't think have changed?
I don't think things have changed, and I think you can pick out the leaders who are perhaps not just paying lip service to it, because I think it is something people talk about a lot. But look at the organisations where there are leaders leading from the front who are really committed to this and making a difference. So it is a cliche, but I also think it's true that organisations become a reflection of their leaders, and we don't have enough leaders championing this who really believe in it.
I think it's important for the tone to be set at the top, because it sends us a powerful message throughout the organisation. But the challenge is that many initiatives at the top don't get fed through properly. So you may actually have line managers who are resistant to offering female returners flexible working arrangements to deal with childcare issues or elder care issues. So again, if an organisation is going to put itself forward as a champion of diversity inclusion, then that has to be pushed through the entire organisation, and you need to spend money on communicating to employees what's being done and why, and actually be prepared to put your money where your mouth is by recognising and rewarding appropriate actions through salary increases and bonuses.
I take it that we'd apply the other way around. For example, my own profession, I think Charles Cotton referred to IT, for example, as being one way and then the other, if I can put it that way, and the legal profession is perhaps an example of things going the opposite direction, where now it's majority female in terms of the solicitor's profession, and the trend upwards, as it were, in the sense of increasingly female. So I take it, or perhaps comment on the difficulty that appears to arise where professions become, or what is it that causes that professions move in one direction or the other, whichever way it is, and how does one approach that, dealing with that?
Well, in the CIPD, about 70% of our members are female, and we are actively working to encourage more men into the profession. If you went back perhaps 30 or 40 years ago, you would have had more men in the industry, because HR was associated with industrial relations, and but that has kind of moved. But in my area, there is that in pay and benefits, again, that traditionally has been more male dominated. So even within certain sectors, such as you said, legal, there may be areas where there are more men, and other parts where there are more women. So it's a case of trying to work out why is that? Is it because certain certain parts of the profession offer greater opportunities in terms of allowing women to balance work and life? And if so, why can't those elements be put into other parts of that profession as well?
Well, I'm just curious, your comment about the legal profession, you referred to women being in certain parts. It's just that the trend now is towards a female profession, and, for example, the solicitor's profession, which is the primary part of it. And in terms of law intake, law students, it is overwhelmingly female. So moving forward, the trend is liable, if that continues, to continue. But in other areas, as has been pointed out, it's, you know, towards having all male or predominantly male. And I'm just wondering, is that a factor? If one has that happening, is that something that can be addressed, avoided? Is it a problem? What view do you take of that? Because it seems to be a theme that has appeared in a variety of areas, whether the balance is one way or the other. And I'm just, is there any comment that can be made on that?
I think it's a very complex issue. So I think part of the issue is a loss in focus on vocational education. I think that the IT industry is an industry that moves very quickly, and there isn't a good awareness amongst parents and even career advisors and teachers in schools as to what careers in the IT industry might look like. So I think that's an issue as well. I think often parents will still encourage their children into the more traditional professions because they don't know what the jobs in IT look like and what kind of career opportunities that can offer. And we seem to have done something that's turning young girls off science and STEM in general. So Accenture recently did a study of 4,000 12-year-old girls and their parents, and age 12 they had decided that IT was for boys. So something's happening in primary school that's long, you know, before you're making your subject choices to go on to further or higher or vocational education. And that certainly seems to be what's happened in IT, and it hasn't happened with IT or STEM all over the world. So it's not true in the developing world. It's not true in places like Russia, where they're very successful at encouraging women into STEM. It is, however, true in the UK. So I think we need to start teaching disciplines like coding in primary school, and that can be fun. I mean, we have just done some work with 12 primary schools in Edinburgh, and part of the issue is the teachers aren't confident teaching. So if the teachers aren't confident teaching, that's not going to work. So we've taken the primary school teachers, and the kids are primary school children learning to code by playing snakes and ladders. One of them wrote an algorithm because they felt the teacher's desk was too untidy, so they wrote an algorithm for the teacher to keep his or her desk tidy. And I think people are a bit scared by it, but actually young children can learn just by playing. And then I think it's a life skill now. I don't think it's just for the IT industry. And B, I think that opens a whole lot of doors. And even if you don't go on, to pursue a career in that area, computational thinking is all about problem solving. So it's a useful skill to have anyway.
Okay, come now to a question from Gil Patterson.
The opportune conversation with my daughter last night. It's strange, isn't it? I wondered, when it comes to gender diversity in boards and a 2020 target for a 50-50 split, if that's likely to happen in your view.
I think it's going to be challenging, but I mean, I think we should have challenging targets, because even if we don't hit them, hopefully we won't be too far away from where we're trying to get. But I think also you have to kind of look at the composition as well. I mean, if you get 50% at the top and 50%, that doesn't kind of, you know, that's, if you get all the men at the top and all the men at the all the men at the bottom, then that's not going to be appropriate. What you need is to make sure you've got the split as much as you can throughout the organisation. So at the CIPD, our senior leadership team is 66% female, which is reflective of overall overall of our workforce, which is 7% female. But it has kind of taken some time to actually get to that level.
I think it will be very challenging, but I think it's still a worthy goal. And I'd rather go for something aspirational and fail than go for something that was less ambitious.
Do you think we need to do something then with, if you're not entirely confident, need to do something with legislation? Or is that, in the long term, unhelpful?
Again, it depends how it's sold. I mean, I think the challenge is if you bring something in which is then seen as a administrative burden by organisations, then there's going to be resistance or tokenism, or it will degenerate potentially into a tick box exercise. What you need to do is kind of win the hearts and minds. And you can do that by either saying, well, you know, this is the right thing to do. Would you want your, you know, daughter or sister being treated like this? Or here are the business benefits. Or here, you know, this is the risk to your reputation if you don't kind of do something along these lines.
So therefore, if we're optimistic and we get to that goal, or near enough that, what benefit do you think? The question that you raise yourself in regards to gender balance and boards, well, that's all very well, it would sound. How does it impact further down the food chain? Do you see that being a major driver to assist women through some of the stages in their development, knowing that, by and large, it looks as if women are the people that take time off for very good reasons, but of course it then brings forward a barrier for progression. Do you see if we have more women understanding what these necessary breaks are at this time, can you see influence in some way?
I think, you know, when it was one of the previous people giving evidence said that women have all the same aspiration but think they're half as likely to succeed. I think seeing more of a gender balance on boards would show younger women coming through that it absolutely is possible. And so I do think it would have a positive effect. And I think it would just changes the chemistry of the board.
Our members have been working in the Manchester area with carers, either childcare carers or elder carers, who've returned, are looking now to return back into the workforce. Predominantly, most of the people are women, helping them with the skills that they'll need to kind of go to interview, but also trying to challenge their assumptions and misconceptions about the types of jobs that they should be going for. You know, you don't have to go into, well, unless you want to, you know, retail and hospitality because they offer part-time jobs, you could think about other types of career opportunities as well, and trying to kind of expand and raise their awareness, and, you know, that so far seems to be working.
And maybe if I could go to the other end of the spectrum, finally, convener, we're talking about the top end and probably mature women, I would think. So when it comes to the actual pipeline, and I posed that question earlier on, where do you think how is the pipeline filled? Is it filled by young people themselves, or is it the schools that have got the big influence, or is it the parents?
Parents are huge. I mean, huge influencers. And that's why I think part of the reason we haven't solved the problem. I think it takes government, parents, schools, further and higher education, and business itself to get involved to solve this. I don't think there's one answer. I think if there was, we'd have found it.
I agree with what Maggie, you can't kind of rely, the government can't do it all on its own, nor can employers, nor can schools. You've got to kind of collaborate together. You need some kind of overarching strategy with targets and ambitions, and flowing from that, policies and practices.
Thank you. Move to John Mason.
Okay, well, following directly on from that then, could we use procurement, perhaps, both local and central government? Obviously, put a lot of money out to contract or to the private sector. Should we be thinking more of trying to put pressure on people who want public sector contracts to have to sign up to more on issue of gender equality?
Well, it's public money, and I'm sure the public want to ensure that their money is being spent on employers that have fair employment practices. I know there are always legal issues about what you can and cannot do when you're writing your contracts, but I don't see why government, as a buyer, I mean, other buyers have, you know, are influenced by these decisions as well as being an employer, you know, being a good practice employer, encouraging right practices among the employees that it has in its own organisations.
I would agree. I think it depends. It's important to get the balance right so that it doesn't become really onerous. I spent a number of years working in North America, and lots of things are written in around not just gender diversity, but all sorts of diversity. So I absolutely think that it would make a difference. However, it's getting that balance right between it being a positive kind of a carrot stick effect, and it not just becoming really onerous for organisations to bid for public sector business. But I do think it would make a difference.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Mr Cotton, you said there was kind of rules around contracts, and I mean, I'm not in favour of Brexit, but do you think there's a possibility that if we have Brexit that would loosen that up and give a bit more freedom to government?
Well, I'm obviously not an expert in European contract legislation, but I mean, often one of the explanations for reasons why there hasn't been government intervention in this area are that there are rules around this. But again, it depends on, you know, what type of Brexit we have. If we have closer working relationships with Europe, we may still have this legislation as well. But I mean, that's speculation. It's not really of my area of my expertise.
Okay. And then, well, my final question, I think, then would be, are there other things the government should be doing or Parliament should be doing to kind of move this whole agenda forward? I mean, schools keep coming up, and I'm beginning to think we should have had the schools here at the committee, but I don't think we have had. But, you know, for example, it was suggested at the last session, if you heard that, you know, maybe we're letting kids opt out of STEM too soon or at all. But are there just, you know, any other things you feel we should be looking at?
Well, leaving aside schools, I mean, you have a role as an employer yourselves to say, well, what are you doing, both central government as well as local government? You know, how are those employment practices flowing within the organisation? This is we talked earlier about statistics. Are you getting the data that you need to be able to analyse the situation? When this gender pay gap report there's a requirement for organisations to put their information onto a government website. What relationship is there between the Scottish Parliament and the UK government around that database? Will you be able to search for data by postcode? Will there be the option for employers or Scottish employers to be able to, when they're entering their data, say, well, this is the data and this is the explanation? So employers are able to kind of head off questions by having the opportunity to kind of explain what's been done and why.
Okay. Ms. Morrison, do you have any thoughts as to what we should be doing?
I think we do absolutely have to do something in schools. You know, I was presenting recently at the launch of the Digital Extra Fund, and I stood up and had been given statistics beforehand and said there are only 8 computing teachers in Highland Region. And the speaker after me said, Maggie's wrong. And obviously I assumed she was going to say 12 or 16. She said there are only 7 because one of them's retired. And I think if we're not able to put that expertise into schools, then it's difficult to see how we will fix the problem. I think we need multiple interventions, and I think we do need to work to change the way young girls think about STEM.
Mm-hmm. Is it partly language? That's been suggested to us a few times that, you know, just some of the terms we use kind of give this, I don't know, male, aggressive, macho image.
I just think it's a lack of understanding about how exciting those jobs can be, and not, you know, Leah Hutchin of Appointed, for example, a great company, young woman, tech focused. I don't think we're getting these role models in front of girls enough, and I think they're probably is still a perception that it's a geeky activity with, you know, guys with long hair and Jesus sandals sitting in somewhere with no light coding, that clearly isn't going to appeal to young women. But one of the other thing about that Accenture study was that 14% of the parents interviewed could quantify what they thought was a good career for their daughters. And I think that's a shocking statistic as well.
Yes. I suppose there's also the issue of trying to encourage boys into a wider subjects as well, and careers such as, you know, social care and teaching.
Okay. Well, we could probably develop that further, but I think that's enough. Thanks very much.
All right. Okay. Well, thank you very much to both of you for coming in today. We'll allow you to depart from the questioning stand, or whatever we want to call it. And we have an item three, which we're to deal with before we move into private session. Item three is the Bankruptcy Fees Scotland Revocations Regulations 2017, which are SSI 2017/97. Does any member have any substantive issues they wish to raise, or are they content that the instrument comes into force? Are we agreed that it simply comes into force? Thank you very much. I'll suspend this, the session, and we'll move into private session. I'll allow the gallery to clear. Thank you.